As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna alhamdulillah, na'maduhu, nasta'inuhu, nasta'gfiruhu. Na'udhu billahi min sharuri anfusina wa min sayyati amalina. Man yahdihi allahu falamudilla la, wa man yudlil falahadiya la. Wa ashadu an la ilaha illallah wahduhu la sharika la, wa ashadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في الله تعالى حق الجهاد حتى أتاه اليقين في صلوات الله وسلامه ورحمته وبركاته عليه أما بعد. Who can tell me before we move forward with the sixth century of the Hijra, what brother, what sister, who can tell me, who can share with us what we spoke about previously in brief? Who can raise their right hand and tell us what we talked about, who we talked about? To make a brief review and revision of the previous session. We have any volunteers? Any volunteers? Anybody who can tell us what we spoke about earlier? Tafadhal akhi. I'm listening. Excuse me? About paradise. Right? No doubt. We spoke about going to paradise through seeking hadith. In general. طيب, فضل أخي. Who? Hassan? No one else? Anybody else? تفضل. Excuse me? Imam al-Daraqutni. What century did he live in? The fourth century. طيب, خيرن. What was so important about the 4th century? In brief, quickly. What was so important about the 4th century? No, it wasn't the golden era. The 4th century wasn't the golden era. It lived in the shade of the golden era. The golden era spawned the 4th century. Adar al-Qutni rahimahullah was a child of the golden era. He was a product of the golden era. Tayyib. Khayrin, inshallah. What else can we mention briefly before we move on, brothers and sisters? Mudhakaratu al-ilmi hayatu. The pious predecessors, they would say, reviewing knowledge is the lifeblood of ilm. Mudhakaratu al-ilm hayatuhu. If you want to keep your knowledge alive, you want it to grow and enhance, then you must review. Review. Khayrin, inshallah. Anything else before we move forward? That's all we talked about for 30 minutes. Was the 4th century in Adar al-Qutni, nothing else? Nobody else? Maybe the lecture was boring. Maybe the class wasn't informative enough. We have no feedback. Must have been a bad session, huh, Samir? It had to be. Nothing else, no one else? Khayrin, inshallah. Let's move forward with what we have tonight. And that is al-Qarn al-Sadis min al-Hijra, the 6th century. The 6th century obviously came after the 5th, and it was before the 7th. The 6th century was a bit contrast, was a bit different than the century of Adar al-Qutni, the 4th century. And we have the following elements of influence. The following seeds of the tree of Ibn al-Jauzi. What made Ibn al-Jauzi, Ibn al-Jauzi? What caused this man to be what he was, to become what he became? Just like we spoke about who? Adar Qutni. And the things which led him to be what he became, by Allah's permission. So we have the following issues with this century among the Muslims, specifically in the region of Ibn al-Jauzi. And the first was, it was a great deal of mental, intellectual stagnation. Not all of the Muslims, but many of the Muslims, their minds became stale. The gears halted. They grinded to a stop, to a halt. People stopped making ijtihad. People stopped using their brains and their minds. And they went back to what we mentioned, what they didn't do in the 4th century. What Adar al-Qutni didn't do. And that was to blindly follow. And that was to make taqdis, huh, of what took place and what happened. But to realize the urgency and the necessity of further refinement and development. But for one reason or another, in the 6th century in general, and in Iraq, which we want to explain where Ibn al-Jauzi came from, many scholars begin to behave like laymen. They begin to just follow. Imam Fulan came before me. He knows best. It's no need for me to think about and to put any type of critical thought in it whatsoever. So this is one of the factors behind Ibn al-Jawzi being such a great scholar of this century. Number two was the crescent and the cross. The crescent and the cross. The battle and the clash between these two iconic symbols, i.e. the Crusades. The Crusades. Anyone who's read history, he knows that there were several battles and several wars and several years in which there was the Crusade battle, in which there was the forces of Christendom versus the forces of the Muslims in the Middle East and in the Far East. There were times in which the Christians were given some type of outward victory. And there were times in which the Muslims had manifest triumph over those who bore those crosses. In the time of Ibn al-Jawzi, there were great casualties, many losses. Many Muslims were killed, slain, and slaughtered. Much knowledge was lost. Many sacred places and locations were destroyed and burnt because of the Christian invaders coming from Western Europe, Germany, France, England, and the list goes on. So this is a factor behind Ibn al-Jawzi being who he was. Number three is another savage, ravaging attack, and that was of the Tatar and the Mongols in the Middle East in general, but specifically in Iraq and Baghdad. There were many battles, many Muslims that were killed. There were countless cities that were sacked. And some of them, they said that when the Tatars and when the Mongols, that's a long discussion, were the Tatars and the Mongols the same people? That's a long discussion. When they entered Iraq and they defeated the Muslims and many of the people were slain on the battlefield, no one was given quarter. Everyone was slaughtered. And they said that there were so many people that were killed that the streets of Baghdad were slippery with human fat. They were slippery, not with blood, but with fat of human beings. Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah, he mentions that there were so many books that were thrown into the sea that the water became black and extremely dark. It was so many books. Now pay attention now. A book is going to be dry. The paper, the parchment, the papyrus, whatever the book is made of, you throw it in water. It's dry, it's crusty, the books are old. So imagine how many books have to be put into the water for the ink to become fresh again. That's how much knowledge was lost during the time of Ibn al-Jawzi. Before him, after him, the general time period of the 6th century and on. The last major problem that Ibn al-Jawzi's time suffered from the 6th century was the overpowering of many of the evil, wicked innovators of Islam. From the Batiniya, from the Rafida, the extreme Shia, not only were they mean and base, hiding in the corner, but they began to have major influence on the leaders. They began to have major influence on the courts. They began to take over and take control. And anyone who was considered Sunni, anyone who was considered person of Hadith, they were literally killed and persecuted. There was one leader of Iraq who was a Rafidi Khabith. He was from the most wicked, the most foul. They said that he would bring the Sunnis, specifically the scholars of Hadith, and he would literally strip them bare of their skin while they were alive. And then he would put them in a pot of boiling water, of boiling oil, and then he would have his followers eat the man, eat his body. This was the persecution that took place to the Muslims in general, the Sunnis, and specifically Ahl Hadith. And I can tell you personally, one day I was on Hajj some years back, and one of the brothers came from the United States who was originally from Iraq. And he started talking about some political issues, the Middle East, Saudi Arabia, Iraq, so on and so on and so forth. He said, Wallahi Yahi, he says, I've seen with my own eyes some of the Rafida in Iraq, in Iraq. They would take Muslims, they would look at their ID cards, they would identify them, Rafidi, Sunni, Shi'i, whatever. And if you were proven to be a Sunni, if you weren't Shi'i, Rafidi, they would literally kill you and they would cook you. And while he told us this story, we were eating on a huge, large plate in which there was rice and there were chicken. He says, I saw Muslims, Sunni Muslims, being eaten just like we're eating this chicken and rice. Without any exaggeration. So this is the extent of the hatred, the malice and the malevolent rancor that these people had against the Muslims in general, specifically al-Hadith. So all of these different things had a tremendous effect on the life, the upbringing of this great scholar of the 6th century. Khayran, inshallah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what did the Muslims do? How did the Muslims counter what took place and what happened of this, yani, these horrible atrocities? The Muslims in general, and once again, and I'll say this openly without any shyness, I am biased and I do have an agenda. There's no doubt about that. I am biased and I do have an agenda. And when we speak, and when we talk, and when we explain, we are propagating hadith, the sciences of hadith, and the scholars of the hadith. There's no doubt about that. And I take pride in this, walillahi alhamd. So the Muslims in general, but once again, specifically the champions of Islam, Ahlul Hadith, there were several things that they did to counter, to fight back against the deck of cards that they were dealt in this 6th century. And from the things that they did is that they looked at the past. They didn't get stuck on the past. They didn't get trapped in the past, but they looked at the past. And they realized that the scholars who had preceded them left behind a huge amount of turath. Turath, yani, dakhm, ha'il. A tremendous legacy that the greater scholars of the 4th, 3rd, 2nd, and 1st century left behind. So they said to themselves, instead of us reinventing the wheel, quote unquote, instead of us making new books, let us revamp the old books. Let us resurface the previous classic, classical, traditional works and bring them back to life and revive them. The good that's in, we need to spread among the Muslims once more. The mistakes, the errors need to be fixed. The things that need to be summarized, the things that need to be refined, and the issues that need to be tuned and tweaked. This is one of the greatest things that the scholars of hadith did in the 6th century. They made inayah tamma, full complete service of the previous classical books. And this is something, in my humble opinion, which is extremely important in 2017. There are things we need to talk about and write and deal with, no doubt about that. But there's a tremendous amount of information. There's a tremendous amount of rulings, of fatawa, of ijtihad, and all of these different things that were mentioned, already explained. However, we don't read enough. We don't study enough. And if the information is there, and we do open up the book, we do listen to the information that's being presented, it needs to be refined. It needs to be summarized. It needs to be redressed in a way in which the young Muslims of 2017 can fully grasp and comprehend. And this was the genius of those great scholars of hadith of the 6th century. Khayran, inshallah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, the different books of hadith, some of these scholars, they reorganized them. They put them in a new tartib. Books that weren't organized in an easy, simple way, they reorganized those books. They explained those books. And they dealt with ulum al-hadith heavily. They started to classify the different terminologies or the language of the people of hadith in a more thorough and consistent manner. Last but not least, what I want to mention in this brief introduction is they did something that was new. They innovated. And this is a very important point in Islamic scholarship. You have the old, you have the classic, you have the traditional, and there must be something that is added to the library. There has to be something that is new. There has to be an innovation in Islamic scholarship. Obviously, when we say innovation, we're talking about authoring. We're not talking about bid'ah. Everybody understand this? So this is a very important thing that they did in this 6th century. And the scholar that I chose to speak about and to explain his life, he was from the forerunners of this. And that was in Sha' Kutub. They made new books on mawdu'atin khasa, on specific issues. Not a jami', not a muwatta', not a sahih, okay? Not a mustakhraj. But they made books just on one specific particular topic. And there lies no doubt the flagship of these books of the 6th century was Ibn al-Jawzi's book, Al-Mawdu'atul Kubra. It was an exhaustive compendium of fabricated spurious narrations. He made a book specifically, not on the authentic hadith, not on the genuine hadith, but on the weak, bogus, and spurious hadith. Why did he do this? Many Muslims today say, why are you talking about the da'if? Why study sciences of hadith? Why do you have to, we have Sheikh Fulan, Imam Fulan, there's no need of it. Ibn al-Jawzi knew that the Crusaders, the Mongols, the Tatars, the Rafida, these evil people, those who were inside of the fold of Islam, outside of the fold of Islam, those who said, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and they were munafiqeen, they were zanadiqa, they were heretics who didn't believe in Allah on the last day. Or those who carried a cross. He knew that all of these enemies, domestic and foreign, the only reason why they had the ability to overcome and overpower the Muslims is because the Muslims lost their identity. The Muslims had become lost. They split up into schisms, into groups. There was too many bogus practices, too many lies. There were too many misconceptions that became spread among the Muslims that caused the Muslims' spirits to almost die, their hearts to almost go on a flat line. And once the soul goes, once the heart goes, the mind goes. And once the mind goes, the body is nothing. It's like a pushover. Once you've taken someone's mind, taken their heart, they have no morality, no spirituality, no spiritual courage. Conquering their bodies is simple and easy. So Ibn al-Jawzi and the other scholars of Hadith, they were smart. And they knew that this was the beginning of reinstituting the greatness of the Muslims that was temporarily lost by the Crusaders or via the hands of the Crusaders, etc. Khayran, inshallah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is what I would humbly say. Obviously, we don't have a lot of time. We have a mixed audience. And this is very important. There are some of us who have a great appetite for hadith sciences. And you want to hear these things and learn these things. There's some of us who are barely coming to listen for the fa'idah. There's some people who are accompanying someone who's coming to the lecture. And there may be some of us who may not be focusing at all whatsoever. So we can't keep it on one gear, one level. But we have to give every single person something to eat, a buffet, bidnillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you're a heavy eater, a light eater, vegetarian, and the list goes on. So Ibn al-Jawzi, rahimahullah ta'ala, these were the main factors in his mindset and what pushed him on that unprecedented path. As far as Ibn al-Jawzi and who he was, then his name was Jamaluddin Abu al-Faraj Abdurrahman ibn Ali. Jamaluddin was his laqab. Shamsuddin, Diyauddin, Nasruddin, that was his laqab. His kunya was Abu al-Faraj, the father of al-Faraj. And his actual name was Abdurrahman, the son of Ali. And he was born in Baghdad. And his lineage is traced back to Abu Bakr ibn al-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He was from the progeny, the offspring of the greatest Siddiq, al-Siddiq al-Akbar of this ummah, Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah was a bit different from Imam al-Darqutni. He was a bit different from Imam Ahmad, Bukhari, and these other people. Imam Ibn al-Jawzi's father died and he was only 3 years old. So he became an orphan. In the Arabic language and in Islam, if your father dies, you're considered an orphan, even if your mother is still alive. And a very interesting fact, Allahu A'lam, why, how, but this is a fact, is that his mother remained alive and she didn't look after him too much for one reason or another. He says, once my father passed away, my mother was never the same. And she didn't really actually raise me and take care of me like I thought she would. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he brought someone else. He placed someone else to look over him, to watch after him, and that was one of his uncles. And another version says, Ammatuhu, his aunt, his aunt. And this goes back to what we mentioned before about women being inspirational, being influential, and someone, a man seeking knowledge. So therefore, either it was his uncle or his aunt who was the one who took him around and introduced him and gave him his first spoonful of ilm. His first spoonful of ilm. The scholars who wrote about his life, they say that Ibn al-Jawzi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he started studying Islam at the age of 7. And some of them say that he memorized the entire Quran at the age of 9. So he was, without a doubt, a prodigy. He had an amazing mind. He had unnatural intelligence and mental sharpness, just like al-Darqutni, rahimahullah ta'ala. Ibn al-Jawzi, he wasn't poor. His family was not poor. They say that his father was a wholesale copper merchant. And he says that his father left behind, he says, uluf, uluf, i.e. millions of dollars. So he came from a very rich and wealthy family. And this was pivotal, crucial, in what he became as a scholar. And that is something, if Allah allows and if Allah wills, we want to shed some light on. the importance of money, the importance of wealth, and the importance of you being free and independent when it comes to studying and memorizing and traveling. So Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah, his father died. His mother didn't look after him. He had his aunt, he had his uncle, and he was extremely wealthy. So when he was younger, they say that his family, they didn't cut any corner and put him in the finest of schools. He had the best education. He was in the Ivy League from a young child. So he had the best Quran teacher. He had the best teacher of the Arabic language. And this is the thing which allowed his weak legs to grow and become strong. And then afterwards, when he learned some of the basic sciences, perhaps we'll read some of the things here, he became interested and he became, we say, quote unquote, addicted to hadith and his sciences. And this is nothing that is strange, and this is nothing that is weird. When we spoke about Adad al-Khutni rahimahullah, and we mentioned three of his most prominent pupils, there's another disciple of his whose name was Abu Bakr al-Barqani rahimahullah ta'ala. And this man, Abu Bakr, he was a great muhaddith, like his teacher. One day he said out to his students, he called out to those who came to listen and those who came to hear what he had to say and dictate to them. And he called out to them, he called them. He says, make dua for me. And yanzi Allahu min qalbi hubb al-hadith. He says, please pray for me that Allah would take the passion of hadith out of my heart. Please ask Allah to remove it from me. فَإِنُّهُ قَدْ أَلْهَانِي عَنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. He says, because it preoccupied my entire life. That's the only thing that's important to me right now. I've learned Quran, I learned tafsir, lugha, tariq, seerah. Those are all good, it's all fine and peachy. But the hadith is where it is. So that was Dar al-Khutni student. And this is something that is very similar that happened to Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala. Ibn al-Jawzi is mentioned that he was so smart, so intelligent. He was not only an Islamic scholar, but he also had knowledge in other fields and in other disciplines. Because Ibn al-Jawzi was wealthy, because he came from royalty, because he came from quote-unquote high stock or good stock, he was high born. He was a prolific writer and an extremely efficient author. And they say that he wrote over 300 books that he left behind. 300 books that survived. How many books may have been burnt, stolen, lost, bookworms, wind, destruction, and the list goes on. But there were 300 books that survived. And from those books, obviously, is the famous classical book called Talbisu Iblis, The Devil's Deception. Which parts of it has been translated into English? Perhaps the whole entire book has been translated into English. I don't know. But I know for sure that there is a part and a section of the book that is in the English language. And this book here is considered to be a paramount groundbreaking work. And that is because Ibn al-Jawzi was very critical on himself and on others. And Ibn al-Jawzi in this book, he doesn't talk about the fornicators. He doesn't speak about the fornicatrices, about the drunks and the drunkards. He doesn't talk about the abusers and the womanizers. No, that's not what he speaks about. He talks about the scholars. He talks about those who recite the Quran, those who memorize the Quran, those who study hadith, those who have zuhd and tasawuf, those who call themselves Sufis and ascetics and so on and so forth. He talks about these individuals. And he proves how shaitan, how Iblis, may Allah's curse be upon him, has tricked and fooled many of them to thinking, because I know something, because I've memorized something, because I have an ijazah, because I studied with this scholar, because I'm treated like royalty, people bring me food, they carry me, I have everything that I want, that shaitan is not going to approach me. He's not going to come to me. Shaitan is not going to try to trick me. He's not going to try to deceive me. So in this book, Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah, he spoke about arrogance, he spoke about conceit, and he spoke about ghurur, you just being duped, you being lost, being full of yourself. And it's a book that I advise each and every one of you to read, the original Arabic version and the summarized version as well. Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala, he has another very important work similar to the first, which is called Saydul Khatir. It's called Saydul Khatir, which is translated to mean my hunted thoughts or the game of my mind, my mind's game. In other words, when I'm sitting down, when I'm walking, when I'm traveling, when I'm about to go to sleep, what pops into my head? Sporadic, spontaneous issues, fawaid, benefits. And we're going to read something to you if we have enough time. In which Ibn al-Jawzi said, the most important thing is to write down these sporadic thoughts. And this is crucially important for the student of knowledge and the student of hadith. Is whenever you hear something, you think of something, you come across something, write it down. Because old age will come. And the Arabs, they say, al-hifdhu khawan. Al-hifdhu khawan. They say that the most treacherous enemy is your own memory. That's the most treacherous enemy. You got it now, you got it today, it's easy, I'm young. Years go by, stress, sins, sickness, illness, and the next thing you know, you cannot remember it. That is why Abdullah ibn Abbas and others, they used to say, إِذَا سَمِعْتَ شَيْءٍ فَاكْتُبْهُ وَلَوْ عَلَى الْحَاطِ. He says, whenever you hear something, write it out, even if it's on the wall. And others from the Sahaba and the Tabi'een, they would write on the bottom of their sandals. They didn't have any money, they didn't have any paper, they didn't have any notebooks, they didn't have tablets. So they write it on their sandals because the fa'ida was so precious. تُكْتَبُ بِمَاءِ الْعَيْنَيْنِ. They said that the fa'ida was so beautiful, so sweet, that it could be written down with ma'u al-aynain, with the tears of your eyes. In other words, you have to make ink from something. Blue ink, black ink, purple ink. And you have to mix it with something. It's some type of water, the base. So the fa'ida is so precious. If you had to take the water out of your eyes and mix it and write it down, it wouldn't be a wasted amount taken from your body. Khayran inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another very important book of Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah is the famous work on history called Al-Muntadhim fi Tariq al-Muluki wal-Umam. He wrote an exhaustive set of volumes regarding the history of the different rulers, the different kings, and the different nations. Another very important book that Ibn al-Jawzi wrote is that which is called Sifatu Safwa. He wrote a book about the description of the chosen slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Starting off, or obviously heavily focusing on the Prophet's seerah, the seerah of his Sahaba, of the Khulafa, and the list goes on throughout the Islamic history. Khayran, inshallah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Obviously, we don't have enough time to mention everything that we want to mention and talk about everything that we want to talk about, but perhaps in the night ta'ala, we'll read a thing or two from his durar, from his pearls, from his golden nuggets, from the gems and the jewels that he left behind. And hopefully, bidin Allah, this can be food for thought for myself and for all of you. And maybe we'll conclude with that. And Allah Azza wa Jalla surely knows best. Ibn al-Jawzi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, with regards to his advice that he gave to the students of knowledge, listen here, bidin Allah ta'ala, he says, and then you get an idea of Ibn al-Jawzi. He says, Faslun. الله يغفر للجاهل قبل العالم رأيت جماعة من العلماء يتفسحون ويظنون أن العلم يدفع عنهم وما يدرون أن العلم خصمهم وأنه يغفر للجاهل 70 ذنبا قبل أن يغفر للعالم ذنب وذاك لأن الجاهل لم يتعرض بالحق والعالم لم يتأدب معه. He says in this book صيد الخاطر, which is considered to be a notebook, a memorandum before he went to sleep. He says, رَأَيْتُ جَمَاعَةً مِنَ الْعُلَمَاءِ. He says, I met many scholars. I saw many scholars, great scholars. They think and they feel that they are beyond, that they are above, that they are saved. They talk about this issue. They discuss that issue. This is halal, that's haram. Abu Hanifa, Shafi'i, Malik, this one and that one. He says, that's what they speak about. He says, and they don't know. They think, they don't know, but they think that knowledge is helping them. He says, but in actuality, knowledge is their enemy. Knowledge is their adversary. And that is because they don't know that Allah Azza wa Jalla will forgive an ignorant Muslim, an ignorant person for 70 sins before Allah forgives a scholar for one sin. The jahil will be forgiven 70 times before the alim is forgiven once. And that is because the jahil is jahil. He doesn't know. He never sought the truth. He doesn't know the truth. He's uneducated. As far as the alim, then not he went against the haq. He didn't act upon the haq. Listen to the closeness, the sharpness of the words. He says, lam yata'addab ma'ahu. He didn't have the proper adab with knowledge. What knowledge do you learn about the malaika? What knowledge do you learn about Allah's seeing and hearing? What do you learn about asma wa sifat, Allah is above the arsh. Allah is the most lofty. He's the most high. He looks down to his slaves. What did you learn about these things? That the angels are pure beings made from light. La ya'sun Allah. They never disobey Allah Azza wa Jalla. They have no lust. What did you learn about these things? What did the Prophet say regarding garlic, regarding onion, and regarding leek? Don't come near the masjid if you eat from one of these three foul plants with a bad odor, bad breath. Why? فَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَ تَتَأَذَّى مِمَّا يَتَأَذَّى مِنْهُ بَنُوا أَدَمُ. He says, because the angels are annoyed from that which the children of Adam are annoyed. The angels, they don't like things that human beings don't like. So how can you disobey Allah, go against Allah's rules? How can you preach, and you notice about the malaika that they hate to see bad things, smell bad things, be bad things? So this is su'ul adab. That's horrible etiquette with the truth. That's horrible etiquette with the malaika, let alone Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he says that the jahil has a better chance than the wicked scholar. And we all know the famous line of poetry. He says, وَعَالِمٌ بِعِلْمِهِ لَمْ يَعْمَلًا مُعَذَّبٌ قَبْلْ عُبَادِ الْوَثَنِ. They said that the learned man who doesn't act upon his knowledge will be brought to punishment before idol worshippers. A learned man, a learned woman who doesn't practice what he or she preaches will be tortured before a person of shirk, because the mushrik is only blindly following his forefathers, his ancestors. The alim read, studied, learnt, memorized. Allah gave him so many things, and he doesn't have an ounce of respect to at least be shy from Allah Azza wa Jal and be shy from the malaika. Last but not least, this great scholar, Abu al-Faraj ibn al-Jawzi, he died in the year 596 of the Hijrah. Some scholars say that he was born 508, some say 509, some say 510, others say 511, and he died 596 of the Hijrah in Baghdad. Please, brothers and sisters, if you get a chance, read more about his life. You'll be amazed at what you find, and Allah Azza wa Jalla surely knows best. Thank you very much.
ليلك وجنة بالدجا في الليل تسريب واسأل عنا لهالمنة قل علامات انت تدريب مدعيكم غايب عنا والحكم ميوز في الغيب ينبغي الإنسان يتأنى ويحكم بأحكام مصيبة لا تحس بالحيف ذا منا النصف ناخذ ونعطيب سوي ميل.
Assalamu alaikum. God, man, that was weak. I mean, you guys treat the other MCs like that, but you can't treat me like that. Assalamu alaikum. I know it's the last, you know, talk of the day, and I see a lot of, but it's Saturday. It's not Sunday. You're not going to work tomorrow. Besides, I think, is Monday a holiday as well? Yeah, there you go. So before I introduce the next speaker, I'm just gonna say something, because I see some people just kind of dozing off a little bit. And that's, you might have questions, you might be sitting out in the audience, and you might have questions in your head. And you may not know when these answers come. So with this last speaker, please give your undivided attention. As the questions that you have in your mind or in your life, the answers may lay in his words by the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So please give your undivided attention. So then our next speaker is the Vice President of Al Maghrib Institute and the Director of Clear Lake Islamic Center. Sheikh Waleed Basuni is the Vice President, and he's the frequent guest speaker at universities, conventions, radio talk shows, televisions, interfaith, and so on and so forth. He is also a member of the North American Imam Federation, Assembly of Muslim Jurists in America, and the Research Committee. Sheikh Waleed Basuni graduated with a Bachelor's in Islamic Sciences from Al-Imam Muhammad University, KSA, did his Master's in Islamic Theology, World Religions, Modern Religious Sects, and Al-Imam Muhammad University, that's where he graduated and acquired a doctorate in theology. He is also an instructor at the American Open University in Alexandria and serves as the Imam of Clear Lake University, as I have mentioned. Sheikh Waleed Busuni has ijazah in reciting the Holy Quran and in several books of hadith awarded by various scholars. So inshallah ta'ala, again, with your undivided attention, I would like to invite at this moment in time Sheikh Waleed Busuni onto the podium. Jazakallah khair.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man walah wa ba'd. All praise due to Allah and His praise and blessings and peace be upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, his family, his companions, and his followers until the Day of Judgment. I was asked to speak about an Imam Abdul Ghani, the son of Abdul Wahid, al-Maqdisi, al-Dimishqi, al-Salihi, al-Hanbali, who actually lived most of his life on the 6th century, even though I'm supposed to cover someone in the 7th century, but because he died just right at the beginning of the 7th century, he was included among the scholars of the 7th century. But, you know, there is a lot of things we can learn from this man's life. Like what I said today, early in the day, the whole point of studying those scholars' lives is to see how can we benefit and learn from their life experience in making our life make more sense. You know, I met a lot of people in my life, and when I ask them what you do and what they do, they go to work every day and they say, what are we doing? We just, you know, go to work for doing living. But a lot of us, doing that while they're not alive. You know, you're making a living, but you're not making a life. There is a big difference between the two. When you study the life of those scholars, you will know how to make a life while you're making a living. How to make a real life that it will remain for generations after you, that impact that you make. Because what really life is all about is not about what degree you earn or what money that you earned. Not about that, it's what real meaning of life. It's about the difference that you made, the legacy that you leave behind. If it is your family, your daughter, your son, your community, your masjid, that's what really the life matters the most. A lot of people confuse between what I call